This is the tale of Louis Le Prince, whose talent with photography inspired him to formulate ideas that would give movement to still images. His invention was about to bring him great wealth, but in 1890 he disappeared without trace, allowing Thomas Edison and the Lumiere brothers to step in and take credit for his creation. Relatively unknown today, Louis Le Prince is now officially recognized as the first person to record motion images on film, giving birth to today's motion picture industry. Louis M. Augustin Le Prince was born on the 28th of August 1841 in Metz, France. His father was a major in the French army and often went to pay visits to a dear friend, someone who would have a dramatic impact on Le Prince and the future of photography as we know it. As a curious child hanging onto his father's hand, Le Prince was introduced to Louis Daguerre, a man who not only captured the young boy's interest, but whose name will forever be linked to the early science of photography. He invented a process where silver-plated copper is polished, treated with fumes to make it light-sensitive, and then exposed in a camera for a certain amount of time until the image appeared. Daguerre sensed the raw talent and keen interest in the young Le Prince, and taught him the ways of photography and chemistry available at the time. These childhood lessons inspired Le Prince down a path of the arts, which saw him go on to study painting in Paris and postgraduate level chemistry at Leipzig University in Germany. After meeting an engineer by the name of John Whitley, Le Prince moved to Leeds, England to work for John's company as a designer. During his time at Whitley's, he met John's sister, Elizabeth, whom he went on to marry 3 years later in 1869. Le Prince started at the Leeds Technical School of Art in 1871 with his wife, where the couple soon built a reputation for color photography on metal and pottery. A decade later, Le Prince and his family moved to the United States while still working under Whitley, where he became manager for a group of French artists well known for large panoramic paintings of military battles. While working in the US, he worked on and developed an unusual camera which utilized 16 lenses for the purpose of a technological race that was ongoing, namely the motion picture, a concept that his competitors were still struggling to make a reality. While they were pondering how to achieve this, Louis had pipped them to the post by several years. Le Prince's first prototype came in the form of a 16-lens camera which rotated between the lenses to take a sequence of frames. He reasoned that for the brain to see a continuous image as opposed to the familiar flickbook effect, there needed to be 16 frames per second. However, this produced an obvious problem. Each lens was, if only marginally, in a different position from its predecessor, and thus the resulting frames, when put in a row and projected, would create a very wobbly set of moving images. Nevertheless, this was Le Prince's first patent. He went on to invent further cameras, each moving a step closer to what would be a remarkable breakthrough in motion picture technology. He came to the conclusion that the images would have to be put onto glass slides, and to have them move in front of a lens, the slides would be on a sort of conveyor belt that would rotate them in order in front of the lens and then back around again so that a continuous projection could be achieved. The first motion picture captured, and it is believed to be the first ever, was shot by Louis from Leeds Bridge in 1888. Le Prince was understandably very proud of his invention and couldn't wait to share his achievements with his wife, who had remained in the US. She was very happy and excited for him and had prepared a small theatre in their home for the grand unveiling. Le Prince packed up his equipment and set off, first to resolve some other business in France, and then intending to make his way to New York to demonstrate his creations and patent the new technology and methods. These demonstrations would bring him much deserved kudos from those involved in the field and extreme wealth from a new era in motion film which his invention would bring about. In early September 1890, prior to his voyage to New York to rejoin his family, Le Prince made his way to Bourges in central France to visit some friends for a few days. Then, on September the 13th, he travelled east to the capital of the Burgundy region, Dijon, where he stayed with his brother Albert. 3 days later, Albert waved farewell to his brother at the Dijon station as Louis boarded the Dijon to Paris express train. When the train arrived at the Parisian station later on September the 16th, Le Prince's friends couldn't see Louis disembarking from the train, even though they scanned the length of the platform. In fact, Louis didn't get off the train at all. After informing the proper authority, a search was made. There was absolutely no sign of Louis or his luggage and belongings. The Dijon to Paris Express was exactly that, express, no stops in between. His brother Albert confirmed his departure, and none of the other commuters reported any strange behaviour or emergency stops or exits. The French police, London's Scotland Yard, and Le Prince's family and friends launched extensive searches and an investigation into his whereabouts, but neither Louis, his belongings, or any clues were ever found. Here are some possible explanations for his disappearance. Suicide. Did Louis commit suicide? And if so, how and why? He may have been able to spring from the fast-moving train during the journey, but surely someone would have found his body, seeing as an extensive search was organized. If he did kill himself, why? He had everything to look forward to. He was clearly excited about demonstrating his invention in New York. And even if it were true, as one historian speculated, that he was on the verge of bankruptcy, he was going to make a fortune in a very short period of time. Suicide doesn't add up for me. Faked death. Again, on the assumption that Le Prince was in severe financial difficulty, cinema historian Jacques Desland suggested in 1966 that Louis agreed to vanish due to problems over money and familial conveniences. The suicide theory and any other proposal based on financial difficulty has been debunked. Le Prince's business was profitable, and his newest success in the race for the first moving picture meant he had no real motive to fake his own death. The familial conveniences suggestion was revealed by a journalist in 1977, who quoted a note shown to him by the director of the Dijon Municipal Library that claimed he died in 1898 in Chicago. Le Prince was said to have moved there for the sake of his family honour as he was homosexual, but there is no real evidence to confirm that to be the case, or even that he was homosexual. Albert, Le Prince's brother, was the last person to see Louis alive and claims to have watched him depart on the express train that he never disembarked from. Perhaps it could be said that Albert had the means to kill his brother, but the real question is of motive. In Jean Mitry's book, Histoire du Cinéma, Mitry claims that the most likely scenario is that Le Prince didn't even board that train in Dijon, and that he was either killed by Albert for money or that Albert made no attempt to stop his suicide. As has been covered already, however, no family or friends at the time felt that Louis was suicidal, and evidence appears to point to the contrary. Le Prince was excited by his new invention and had a profit-making business. To me, it would appear someone close to Louis betrayed him, whether friend or family. Someone knew that he was about to make a fortune from his discoveries and wanted that wealth for themselves. Not knowing the relationship between him and his brother, I wouldn't like to speculate, but this is a possible scenario. In 1889, Le Prince was about to patent his new projector as well as exhibiting his new motion picture in New York. The race to achieve this had, for all intents and purpose, been won by Louis, and patenting his invention would secure his legacy in cinema photography and ensure that he became fabulously wealthy. This prompted the Le Prince family's suspicion of Thomas Edison over a patent known as Equity 6928. The result of who was awarded this patent was the person who would have invented the moving picture camera, and it was of great importance. The American Mutoscope Company initiated litigation against Edison in a war over the patents of Equity 6928. Hoping to have Le Prince properly credited for the creation of the motion picture camera, and called upon Adolphe Le Prince, Louis's eldest son, to be a witness. Adolphe had worked closely with his father on a number of his experiments, and the hope was that the court hearing his many achievements would gain Le Prince the recognition he so deserved. Unfortunately, the initial case was awarded in favor of Edison, and just 2 years later, any hope of an appeal was shattered when Adolphe Le Prince was found dead on Fire Island near New York while out hunting ducks. A photograph of a drowning victim from 1890 resembling Le Prince was discovered in 2003 during research in the Paris Police Archives. Sadly, no more information about the picture is available at this time, but some people believe that this photo is of Louis. The body was of a drowning victim. If it is him, and we will probably never know, how did he arrive in Paris, if not on the train he was supposed to be traveling on? This mystery haunts me. Whatever the cause of his untimely death, Louis Le Prince's legacy has been growing ever since. In recent years, Le Prince has been credited as the original inventor of the moving picture camera, and his genius is finally being recognized. Well, my friends, what do you think happened to Louis? Do you think he killed himself? Was he murdered? I don't really hold with the theory that his brother had any involvement, because there isn't any record of him applying for the patent afterwards or being involved in any of the court cases to get the rights to his invention. So I can't see what the brother would have had to gain unless he was paid by somebody. These are all just theories. I don't think we'll ever know, but it does seem very strange that he would disappear on the day before he was traveling back to New York to unveil his invention, and without any doubt to make a huge fortune from that invention. It does seem very suspicious. And also the fact that his son died in a, I suppose it was a shooting accident while out hunting ducks. Can't get any more information on that, whether it was an accident, did he shoot himself, or did one of the hunting party he was with shoot him, or was he assassinated? If only we knew these facts, that would give us a clearer picture. And this idea of the faked death because he may have been homosexual, that doesn't really hold with me either. I mean, him and his wife had a close relationship, from what I can gather. They worked together on, you know, producing photographs on metal and enamel, I think it was. It might have been a meeting of purely minds. Maybe he was leading a double life. But even if that were so, why, after working obsessively for decades on inventing the motion picture camera, would he just skedaddle on the last day off to America, hiding somewhere with his lover, and just watch Thomas Edison and the Lumiere brothers take credit for his invention? I can't see that happening. I can't see that as a possible reason for his disappearance at all. So I'm discounting that totally. That doesn't wash with me. I'm sure his wife was devastated, and there's no way that he would have not have contacted her if he was alive, or his son either. So he was obviously dead either that day or shortly afterwards, but I don't think he was alive. And the people who met the train, they had it searched. He didn't arrive on that Dijon to Paris express. He wasn't on it. So if that was his body found by the French police and dragged from the water, how did he get to Paris? We'll get to the body part soon, but it's just one of those things. It's infuriating. You can't go back in time and see what happened, but it doesn't look like he actually got on that train, or if he did, was he thrown out of the window and picked up along the tracks and taken to Paris and dumped in the water? That doesn't seem like a realistic scenario to me. That seems like a lot of work, and things could go wrong. You could be seen doing that. So I don't think he actually got on the train. He was killed before he got on. But we won't know. But let's have a look at the photo now from the Paris police archives of the drowning victim. Okay, here we see bottom right Louis, presumably taken not long before his death. We have those sort of mutton chop sideburns. And then we look at the morgue photo of the drowned victim. The eyebrows are very similar. If you look at the curves of the eyebrows, there are a lot of similarities, even with the nose structure. This guy appears, I don't know whether they're marks, bruises on his face. Yeah, or maybe they're just sort of marks on the photograph. I don't know, but the beard of the drowning victim appears to be a full beard. And beards were very common back then. Most men had them. As you can see on Louis's photograph, he has his chin shaved, the drowning victim has a beard. Maybe he just didn't shave for a few days, we don't know. As I say, the eyes and the eyebrows do look very similar. But we're judging from a photograph that's not of high quality. It could be him. That's what makes this case even more infuriating, because all we have is that one morgue photograph. Very old, not very distinct, and they didn't have DNA back then, so that this is what we have, a real mystery. If that is Louis's body that was taken from the river, then how did he get to Paris? That's what I would like to know. How did he get to Paris when he wasn't on that train? So it's one of those mysteries that just leaves you with more questions. And it delights me but annoys me at the same time, because I'm constantly turning over in my head what might have happened to him. And if somebody did kill him, who did it? Who did it? There are a few suggestions in the internet who might have done it, but I'm not going to make any accusations against people who are dead now anyway. I do hope you enjoyed this little mystery that I have presented for your enjoyment, and can't really think of anything more to say, so I look forward to seeing you next time around. And yeah, Halloween's coming up. I'm really hoping I've got a video for Halloween. I'm working on it. I got a lot of work in my real life too. I will be definitely trying to make a Halloween video. So yeah, fingers crossed. Anyway, thanks for watching and bye bye. Just a reminder to my beautiful supporters on Patreon, I have a new mini historical feature up for you now. Just put it up there. So go and check it out if you haven't already. And to anyone else who's not a member of Patreon and would like to join, it's very easy. And for a donation as little as a dollar or however much you would like to donate, you can watch this new mini historical feature. And there's a few others too that are not available on YouTube. These little extras are just to show my gratitude to those who support me in this way, that maybe one day I could do this full time and bring you more videos. And yeah, if you want to come aboard Patreon and come to my page, same name, Obsolete Oddity. There's some great people there. You've seen them on YouTube, no doubt. They're in the comments section and they're really nice people. They'll make you feel at home. So please come along if you can. If not, stay here. There'll be more videos here too. Thank you. Bye.